Delhi, the national capital, the birthplace of major politicians in the country, Sheila Dixit, Arvind Kejriwal. Delhi also one state that has not been swept by the Modi wave, not at the peak of his popularity in 2014, not even now. Delhi, which has now, after a bill passed in Parliament late last night, has seen a transfer of power happen altogether. And this transfer of power has gone to the Lieutenant Governor. The Delhi government, the central government in fact, who appoints the Lieutenant Governor. The crux of this new bill is that Delhi government is there for administration, but all the executive orders that the Delhi cabinet now passes will be subject to approval by the Lieutenant Governor. This essentially means that there will be sort of central government hand-holding everything, deciding on all matters in the national capital. Now, this has led to a lot of people asking, then why did Delhiites even vote? Will they even vote in the future now? If the central government is now going to have the final word. It also talks about what about the mandate of over 2 crore people who voted in for the Delhi government. So a bitter political battle at the moment is on the streets of the national capital. Aam Aadmi Party, if I know them correctly at all, is likely to take it to other states as well and say this is what is happening. There are several hashtags doing rounds. One is Black Day of Democracy, other one is BJP scared of Kejriwal. Arvind Kejriwal's top minister, Manish Sisodia, held a press conference also not very long ago and said that this is being done because in the country where there seems to be no alternative emerging for Prime Minister Narendra Modi, there is one Arvind Kejriwal who's managed to build a niche for himself. Well, is that correct? Is that what we're looking at? Or is there merit in what the BJP is saying? Many also highlighting that look at examples and international examples and what happens to states and sort of capital cities across the world. We look into that. We have a panel which is pretty fair, I think, from all political parties and spectrums. We'll get into that. But first, the most important voice is that of the Delhi Walas. Sonakshi now joins us live. Sonakshi, the only question at this hour is, while politicians continue to bicker, what are Delhi Walas thinking?
Absolutely. What are the Delhi Walas saying? Because this is really about the Delhi Walas as well. The Delhi people elected Arvind Kejriwal to form a government. And now it no longer really is going to be that because
all of whatever the Delhi government will do will have to consult the LG first. So let's just go straight to the people and ask them what is their opinion. Aapki rai kya hai? Abhi jo sanshodhan bill jo abhi pass kiya gaya hai parliament mein. Aapko pata hoga uske baare mein. Aapki kya rai hai? Sankshep mein bataiye.
Meri rai ye hai, madam, ki jo bill pass hua hai wo galat hai. Kyunki CM ki power sari chhin li gayi hai, to uska CM kya karega? इस हिसाब से तो सीएम होना ही नहीं चाहिए. अगर सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट ने एलजी के थ्रू ही कुछ चलाना है तो सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट चलाए.
अच्छा,
एलजी को हटा दिया, इसको हटा दिया जाए सीएम को. फिर गवर्नमेंट की जरूरत क्या है स्टेट गवर्नमेंट की यहाँ पर?
जी, you know, in the ITO market here, one of the big markets in the area, a lot of people here, different kinds of shops in this area. मैं आपसे जानना चाहूंगी आपकी राय इसके बारे में. ये बिल जो है, संशोधन बिल जो पास किया गया है, NCT बिल, जहाँ पे LG को सब पावर दिया जाएगा कुछ भी डिसीजन लेने से पहले दिल्ली सरकार को, आपकी क्या राय है इसके बारे में?
पहले तो ये केंद्र सरकार का राज्य आता है, केंद्र सरकार के अंदर है. ये बिल जो है 1991 से लटका पड़ा था कांग्रेस के राज्य में से. जो भी इस टाइम राज्यसभा में, संसद भवन में जो बिल पास हुआ, देश के हित में ही हुआ है और अच्छा ही हुआ.
क्या आप मानते हैं कि अभी दिल्ली सरकार जो है कुछ भी करने से पहले
मन मर्जी से किसी को दिल्ली को कंगाल बना देगी आप सरकार?
तो आप मानते हैं कि LG की राय लेने से दिल्ली सरकार जो है, मतलब दिल्ली के लिए अच्छा है ये?
हाँ, दिल्ली के लिए अच्छा है.
अच्छा जी. So some of the people here, the voices here saying, one says, one believes that, well, what is happening is wrong and well, what has happened is wrong. The other person believes here saying that this is completely in the favor of the national capital because, well, it does come under the center in a lot of ways. आपसे जानना चाहूंगी, what is your opinion on the NCT bill that has been passed in the parliament?
मैम, ये जो लिया है इन्होंने निर्णय, गलत है. जब केजरीवाल की सरकार यहाँ पे है तो उनको ही पूरा हक होना चाहिए, जो भी डिसीजन है वो लेना चाहे.
अच्छा।
अब वो एक तरह से इंटरफेयर हो गया है कि इनके मतलब ये ना चला पाए या जो भी है कह सकते हो आप. लेकिन गलत है ये, पावर केजरीवाल के पास होनी चाहिए।
पावर प्ले जिसे कहते हैं हम, पावर प्ले हो रहा है, ये आम जनता के लिए ठीक है नहीं है?
होना चाहिए,
ये होना चाहिए, आप कह रहे हैं ये होना चाहिए, तो एलजी की राय लेनी चाहिए, कुछ भी होने
लेनी चाहिए। इतना हंगामा हुआ है और जो है और दंगे भी हुए हैं, ये सब इन्हीं लोगों की मिली भगत है।
सो दोज आर सम ऑफ द वॉइसेज ऑफ द दिल्ली वालास रियली सेइंग दैट वेल सम बिलीव दैट दिस इज बीइंग डन इन द फेवर ऑफ द नेशनल कैपिटल, वेल सम से दैट दिस इज रॉन्ग एंड दैट दिस इज अ पावर प्ले एंड दैट वॉट एवर दैट वी हैव डन, वी इलेक्टेड द दिल्ली गवर्नमेंट, वेल देन द सीएम शुड बी रियली हैविंग ऑल द पावर्स। And a lot of people really believing, some of the other people that I spoke to earlier in the day also are of the opinion that what has happened and the manner in which this has happened is really unconstitutional, or rather partly unconstitutional.
Right, how fascinating. Even a random group of people we've spoken to, there's a split verdict over here, completely 2-2. So very fascinating what's happening. Let's break it open to our politicians. Now we've got representations from BJP, we've got Geeta Bhatt, Abhishek Dutt from the Congress Party, Reena Gupta will be joining us shortly from the Aam Aadmi Party, and then we've got a legal expert, Sanjay Hegde, as well. Oh, Reena is with us. Great. So let's also now get the first word from Geeta Bhatt. Geeta, could you explain to us what exactly is the rationale behind this bill? Because like the hashtags are talking about, what Arvind Kejriwal is also saying is that just because you could not get Delhi sort of under the Modi wave, under your wraps, this is an attempt to sort of get in and clutch on to power through other means.
Well, Sonal, first of all, I would like to correct you that I am not representing the BJP over here on this panel. I am here as an independent voice, and I am trying to put forward, you know, what I think is the case over here. Okay. Now, as your reporter had also showed that, you know, there is a divided house. Like, some people are of the opinion that this is wrong, and some are saying no, this was required to be done. Mm-hmm. The fact remains that in 1991, the amendment which was brought in Article 239A and in B, where it categorically said was that the Lieutenant Governor is going to be, you know, the advice of the Lieutenant Governor has to be taken in taking any kind of a decision that the government is going to, Delhi government is going to take. And this was based on basically a committee which was constituted in sometime in 1987. And that committee basically had put forward many measures which were related inter alia to the relationship or streamlining the, you know, the administrative setup between the center and Delhi. Now, also that very categorically mentioned that it is important to note that Delhi is the capital of the country, and hence even among union territories, there has to be a special status that has to be given to Delhi. And keeping this in mind, this provision was already there. It is just that a further clarification has been brought to it. And in fact, it is not that the Delhi government does not believe in it, because if you look at I was looking at the Netaji Subhashchand Institute of Technology Act, which was passed in 2018, that which has been passed by the Assembly, Delhi Assembly, very categorically says that government means Lieutenant Governor of the National Capital Territory of Delhi. That okay. itself, which was passed sometime in 2018. So the fact is that it is something.
I've heard your point. So since you threw some facts and figures, let me like just counter that from some basic stuff that, having covered Delhi extensively, I have also noticed, right? So it was actually in 2003 that L.K. Advani had brought in a bill for full statehood in Parliament. It couldn't go through. It had to be sent to a standing committee. The last three elections in Delhi that I have covered, BJP has gone ahead and asked for full statehood in each of its manifesto. Right? We have also seen a stance where you're talking about, you heard a gentleman there, and this is a bit of a disparity where people don't understand the division of power here. You talked about what the law says. Well, the Supreme Court, when the full statehood and who gets to decide what, that case went to the Supreme Court, they said very categorically that except police, public order and land, Delhi government stands to decide on all these issues. So legally speaking, till this bill came in, Delhi government had those powers. So that's not true what you're saying, really. I'll give you a quick chance to respond, and then I'll get in the other panelists.
Yeah, you know, the Supreme Court also rejected that a full statehood should be given to Delhi. That also is there, you know, in the same judgment. And also, you see, there are, being a capital city, please see the kind of administration, the way it has been handled. I want to give one small example, and that is of the 12 colleges of Delhi University where a financial aid is being given by the Delhi government. For the last 5 months, salary is not being paid to teachers, to professors in these colleges, to non-teaching staff, and also to, you know, the contractual staff. It is, the people have to break their, you know, their fixed deposits. They have to take out money from PF for running their homes. Right. I mean, this is so inhuman. But why is it that just because the financial aid is being given by the government,
I agree.
The Delhi government,
I agree that there have been glitches.
With the doctors,
right. There have been glitches, I'm sure, at the hand of... Right. There have been glitches, like I said, on the part of Delhi government as well. But Geeta, in the past year, let me not even go very back. In the past year, if we talk about the big sort of problematic issues for the national capital, it has been the Delhi riots controlled by Delhi police, which is under the Home Ministry. We are talking about other issues when it came to land deals and this, etc. So, I mean, I'm just saying that a big problem areas when it comes to the national capital, even today, most of them, those key issues, are currently also under the Home Ministry. Okay, so let me bring in Reena Gupta at this point. Reena, while having said that, my question to you is, if we keep politics aside for 1 minute, and I'll really urge you to do that, you know, I know it's difficult, but try and keep that aside for a minute and look at it from a more federal structure point of view. If you look at some of the key capital cities across the world, most of them do not have governments of their own. And I want to quote some to you. Like in Canada, in Australia, in Mexico, in Brazil, most of their capital cities, in fact, in US, Washington, D.C., they have a representative, but that representative in House of Representatives doesn't even have the voting powers. So this is a trend or perhaps a formula that we've seen across the globe. So the question is, why not Delhi?
So Sonal, I think the 2018 judgment of the Supreme Court was very clear. Because Delhi is a capital city, so certain subject matters like police, law and order and land were still with the central government, keeping in mind the federal structure and also keeping in mind that it's a capital city. But also at the same time, we need to recognize that it does have an elected legislative assembly. So if you're going to give all the powers to LG, then what is this legislative assembly going to do? Then you should just go ahead and say, we dissolve the legislative assembly and convert Delhi into a union territory.
Yeah, that might happen.
Take it back. So convert it into a union territory. Then why hold elections? You know, why hold elections? So Delhi is somewhere between a full state and a union territory. And the only comparison of Delhi is actually Puducherry. So I don't understand why people keep coming on TV programs and keep saying it's a UT. It is not a UT. It is more than a UT and less than a state because it has a legislative assembly.
But so on the point of international sort of examples that we have.
Yeah, that's the reason why you have police still with the central government. Because it's a capital city, you need to ensure that there's VIP protection and all of that. And so the point is that all of this was clarified very, very well in the 2018 judgment of the Constitutional Bench of the Supreme Court. So there was no reason for this amendment. The only reason why this amendment has come out is because the BJP has realized that in Delhi, it has no standing. You know, in the last MCD by polls, it did not even manage to get one seat. And, you know, their dream of forming a government is in Delhi has not been realized for 25 years. So what they're trying to do is trying to control Delhi from the back door.
But so, Reena, like, you know, I tomorrow, said, keeping politics aside, all of these are fair points and we pointed that out. And I counted Geeta when she said that. I want to understand from you, on the point of international standards, where do you stand?
This is purely political, Sonal. So, for example, tomorrow in my constituency, if I'm not getting water and suppose the schools are not doing well, the hospital is not doing well, where will I go? Will I go to the LG or will I go to my MLA, whom I've elected? And I have a right to knock at his or her door and saying that why are these basic services not being provided to me? So this is what elections are for. You know, the LG is a selected person. He is not an elected person. So how can the LG rule all over us? So, you know, it is a loss for us. I mean, NDTV is going on this saying that, you know, big face off for Arvind Kejriwal. It's not a face off for Arvind Kejriwal. It's a face off for all the voters who have voted in the government.
No, no, hold on. Also, hold on. Hold on.
From last
NDTV is not saying face off. Let me correct
that
you.
Is actually,
Manish Sisodia, just held a press conference. Reena, I have to correct you there. Manish Sisodia just held a press conference and he said this is not an attack on Delhi, this is an attack on Kejriwal. He made it personal. Manish Sisodia said that this is being done to put down and sort of muzzle the voice of Arvind Kejriwal because they are scared of Arvind Kejriwal. NDTV did not say that. Manish Sisodia went out and said that this is being done because they do not get to have power in Delhi and because people have elected Arvind Kejriwal. NDTV has not said that. But having taken your comments, let me bring in Abhishek Dutt and understand the Congress's point of view. Abhishek, manifestos obviously say a lot of things. I'll come back to you, Reena. Manifestos say a lot of things, both for BJP, for the Aam Aadmi Party, even for the Congress. Everybody asks for full statehood. Now that that's not happening, Aam Aadmi Party obviously likely to contest it. We don't know what's going to happen, how long the battle is going to go really. They might take political mileage out of it also in other political states. But where does the Congress stand in all of this?
See, Sonal, yesterday during the Lok Sabha, a member of parliament and even in Rajya Sabha, they had very clearly expressed that it's a murder of democracy in Delhi. There's an old saying in which says power corrupt and absolute power corrupts you absolutely. And it's not only about Delhi. If you look at the background, whether it's Karnataka, Goa, Arunachal Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Rajasthan, look at any state. Wherever BJP is
losing
badly.
No, but they legally passed it. How is this death of democracy? I mean, the law and the constitution keep changing, right? That's what parliament is for.
So, then why do you need MLAs? Even if you look at the Bharatiya Janata Party election manifesto, even during the time when late Saif Singh Verma ji was the chief minister of Delhi, even when Madan Lal Purana ji was there, Sushma Swaraj ji was there, they all had one agenda very clear, which talked about complete statehood. Now, they pick up something which has never been a BJP stand. I don't understand by the failing popularity of Bharatiya Janata Party in Delhi, which was very evident in the last municipal by-elections, where even Shalimar Bagh, which is a BJP bastion, they lost that seat. There is one seat where they got 102 votes. So that is very clear that Bharatiya Janata Party is not winning in Delhi. So when they don't win election, they tweak a law, which was very, very, very clearly defined by Supreme Court 5 bench in 2018, where each and every part of whether it was Honorable LG, whether it was the Chief Minister, it was very clearly defined. So after such a good definition
but
by the Supreme Court...
I don't know how is it death
Court,
of democracy. It could be death of federalism, one can call it that. But it has been done in a very democratic way. They have the numbers in Parliament, they've done it. Unless you're talking about a legal complication here, which I'm not aware of.
Sonal, just because you have the numbers in the Parliament does not mean you start killing democracy. Tell me something. What will any MLA minister or chief minister of Delhi do now? Under subsection 2 of section 44 in this act, it very clearly says that any decision taken by the honorable ministers can be cancelled by the LG. When LG means government, then what will an MLA do? What will a minister do when any law that you make and it doesn't suit the Bharatiya Janata Party? So automatically through that LG, that law will be cancelled. So why waste taxpayers' money? Why do you need a chief minister? Why do you need his office? Why do you have to give him salaries? Why do you need his cars?
Right.
So that expenditure should be saved. If LG means government, then you don't need MLAs in Delhi. All 70s MLAs should be called off.
Okay. Let me bring in Sanjay Hegde now. Sanjay, the heart of the issue here is also to be understood perhaps with a little bit of history that has gone on between the LG and the chief minister. They are political adversaries to start with. Right? They are known to not agree on anything at all. There were some screenshots doing the rounds where the LG had apparently liked a tweet which was very unkind towards Arvind Kejriwal earlier in the day. Well, maybe unliked it later. I couldn't find it on his timeline at least. But what I'm trying to say is that we've basically replaced one politician to an unsaid another. The trend that we've seen with the way left-hand governors have been used or the Democratic chair has been compromised, to say the least, that's likely to happen here as well then.
How do you say the LG is a politician? Does he get elected? He doesn't get elected. He's appointed. He's a bureaucrat who is liked by some politicians who are in the center.
And that's so what has at happened, their mercy.
Yes, he's there at their mercy. And as some other panelists pointed out, if I don't get water in my constituency in East Delhi, I can't go and tell Manish Sisodia, why am I not getting water? I will have to go to the LG. I don't know whether I can breach the secretariat or his house or anything. Mm. But the LG has no incentive to keep his doors open to the ordinary public. Mm. Whereas any elected politician who's up for elections continually every 5 years, generally keeps an open door to the public.
As accountability.
See, I heard you about all these international models, Washington, D.C., this, that, and the other. Mm. But Delhi is also unique in a particular sense. Delhi was just about 14 lakh people at the time of independence. Mm. Today, it is nearly 3 crore population. Mm. We've heard the Prime Minister, when he was Chief Minister of Gujarat, saying, Mara 5 crore Gujarati. Mm. So where are the 3 crore Delhiites to go? Mm. Just because there is a capital city, are they to be denied representative government? Hmm. And by the way, this is not unique only to the BJP. Hmm. The first chief minister of Delhi in the Congress era of Nehru ran into fights with the then Home Minister G.B. Pant. Chaudhary Brahm Prakash, I've set it all out in an article in the Hindu on Tuesday. Hmm. Chaudhary Brahm Prakash got into fights with the administrator as well as the Home Minister. Hmm. Ultimately, that's exactly what the Congress also did in those days. They just turned Delhi into a union territory. They did not give it even a legislative assembly. 10 years later, then they came out with the Metropolitan Council. Hmm. We have actually regressed back to those days. Hmm. From what the BJP was promising in 2004, full statehood. And the full statehood formula also, I do agree, may not work entirely in a federal capital. Hmm. So what you have to basically do, given the large population of Delhi, which needs representation, is to carve out a smaller federal area like the NDMC area. Hmm. Over that, the federal government should have full control.
Right.
But if there is a tap which doesn't work in Nangloi, do I go and catch the lieutenant governor or the union home minister? Hmm. That's not how you... operate.
I think lots of important points there in what Sanjay Hegde is saying, especially about accountability. That is really key. We'll dwell on that on the other side of this very quick break. Stay with us. Welcome back. We are talking about what happens next for the national capital now that most of the powers are going to rest with the lieutenant governor appointed by the central government. Let's go back to our panel now. And I want to pick on what Sanjay Hegde had said just before going on the break. Now, political ambitions of parties aside and keeping politics aside and keeping only the interest of Delhi Walas at the heart of it, he makes a very good point, Geeta Bhatt, on the fact that whose door am I going to go and knock and what incentive does the LG have to ensure that he stands by people?
Sunil, that exactly was the point that I have talked. I talked about this, that when this power was vested with the Delhi government at that time also, there is an echo, if you can please correct it. That time also, we are seeing at present also how there has been such, you know, violation of human rights where the salaries are not being paid to university teachers, non-teaching staff. We have seen in the past how the doctors during one of the toughest period when there was a lockdown, we could see that there were strikes happening in, Delhi government controlled hospitals because the doctors were not being paid their salary in time. So these kind of, this kind of lapses we are seeing now and then. However,
but you how see, will you ensure it doesn't happen in LG's in charge?
I'll
come to you, Reena. I'll give you a chance to rebut that.
I'm trying to bring a counter to what Mr. Hegde had said. Hmm. So these things are happening, but the fact remains is that it is very well in the 1991 amendment also, it is very clear that, if any kind of a change or an act that has been passed by the Delhi State Assembly, it has to go to the lieutenant governor and his advice.
No, Geeta, you're not giving me a solution. You're only criticizing them. You tell me how will the LG ensure that these salaries are paid? Is there a model?
You see this now. In the coming time, we will see that how this is going to be resolved with this. In any case, there is no per se change that has happened. You see, this already existed. Only thing is that there has been a clarification which has been brought so that wherever there is even an iota of doubt, that has been clarified by.
I'm not very convinced by that answer. Neither are the rest of the panelists. But let me go to Reena Gupta. Then I'll go to Sanjay Hegde. He's also taking his.
If you give me 10 seconds, I would like to put.
I'll come back to you. Let Reena respond. I'll come back to you. Huh?
So first of all, Sonal, Geeta ji should be bold enough to say that she's representing BJP because she's totally distorting
Reena,
the facts.
Reena, come on. Let's talk about the issue. Don't make it personal.
There was no strike in any of the Delhi government hospitals.
No, let's not do that. Reena, let's stick to the issue, please. Yeah.
There was no strike in any of the Delhi government hospitals. The strikes were in the MCD hospitals. We have given every penny as described by the Finance Commission to the MCD. MCD is an adda of corruption. You keep giving them money and the money just goes down the drain and into the pockets of the councillors. So please, let's not get into it. And the strikes were only in MCD hospitals. There were no strikes in Delhi government hospitals.
Okay.
That's point number one.
Okay.
Point number two, you really look at the history of what has been happening in the last 3-4 years, last 6 years actually. Wherever BJP has not been able to come into power through fair elections, they have just gone and bought MLAs of the other parties and tried to form the government. Whether it's Karnataka, whether it's Goa, whether it's Madhya Pradesh, Pondicherry, we've seen it everywhere. They try to do the same thing in Delhi. They try to buy the AAP MLAs. They did not manage. So what they're doing now, they're saying, okay, we are going to behave like the big bully. We can't, we can't come to power in Delhi through any fair means. So we will just go ahead and change the law itself because we have majority in parliament. You know, but there has to be a rationale for changing the act. There is no rationale. Things were going smoothly after the 2018 judgment of the Supreme Court. The files were getting cleared, whichever files were being sent, because there was a good distribution of power between the LG and the Chief
Sanjay
Minister.
Sanjay Hegde, please.
So no new clarification was required.
Right. Got your point. Sanjay Hegde.
See, the point is, ultimately, forget parties. Why should the Delhiite have to go to an unelected person to sort out his problems? Why should the Delhiite be deprived of the power of the ballot? The MLA, the Chief Minister are all our temporary servants. We can fire them at the next election. But I don't have the power to fire the Lieutenant Governor. My only power is to fire the central government. And that the citizen of Delhi alone cannot do. Unless the people of UP and Bihar cooperate, you cannot overthrow the central government.
That's a fair point. Abhishek, that as a point there. Abhishek, go ahead.
There are two things. I was listening to the Aam Aadmi Party and the Bharatiya Janata Party spokesperson before this. She talked about salaries. The AIIMS doctor were on a salary strike.
Abhishek, but that's not an issue here. Let's not digress. No. This debate is not about what strikes happened. I can also say, doorstep delivery is also happening. So many new flyovers are built. But let's not go there. Yeah, come on. Abhishek, this debate is about who gets to run Delhi. And I want to understand what is in the best interest of Dilliwalas. I am a Dilliwala. I am concerned.
See, Delhi enjoys a semi-state status where there are a lot of benefits that Delhi government enjoys from the center. Whether it is police, Delhi police, whether it is central universities, whether it is central hospitals, approximately 26,000 crore is what the center spends on Delhi. But that does not mean that we have the numbers. You'll chop off the powers of the Delhi elected assembly. Tomorrow you could do that to West Bengal. Tomorrow you could do that to another state. And tell me something, Pondicherry elections are happening very soon. Will this be part of the Bharatiya Janata Party manifesto that in Pondicherry, Bharatiya Janata Party wins? This is what they'll do to Pondicherry. It is absolutely absurd. Okay. To defeat democracy
okay, I have to,
in an autocracy.
I have to wrap it now, but I want to understand this. Sanjay Hegde, legally speaking, are there any options for the Aam Aadmi Party at the moment to sort of explore this, push back this bill, contest it in courts, etc.?
Of course, they will be contesting it in court. And there are larger questions of the constitution, the federal structure,
at least in the case of Delhi, as well as in the case of Jammu and Kashmir and any other states which they convert into union territories. The question is whether India is to be a union of states or union territories to be centrally administered. Are we going back to a unitary constitution?
That is a bit. And Reena, if I can get a word from you, can you give us an insight into the strategy? What's happening next? Well, knowing Arvind Kejriwal, he loves a good fight. He's likely to take it to the streets. He's likely to bring this issue in other elections as well. So, give us an insight.
Sonal, we are here to serve the people of Delhi, and we will do everything, whether it's going to the Supreme Court or going back to the people, doing more dharnas, whatever it takes. We want to make sure that Delhi is the best managed capital of the world. And that is our dream and our vision. And we'll do everything. We will leave no stone unturned.
Okay. Geeta, about closing comments, I just want to understand from you, is this a bit of a self-goal by BJP in a way that you've given Arvind Kejriwal just what he wanted? A reason to fight. He's good at it. He's still a politician who thrives at being on the road. He loves a good fight, like I said. You've just given him that.
Well, Mr. Kejriwal, you know, he's been elected by the people of Delhi. I do not understand why there has to be a sense of insecurity, you know, and with an overwhelming mandate he has been elected. But the fact remains is that when we are talking about the, you know, capital of India, and you yourself gave many examples that how across the world, wherever there is, you know, the governments are based on federal principle, their capital cities, they do not have, you know, their independent jurisdiction. And also it is important is that in the last couple of years, the jurisdictional morality which was required to maintain this balance between the center and the Delhi government, that was something which wasn't actually being followed or practiced by the government. That is where it was falling short. And that is why this clarification was somewhere required. There is no change happening. It is just the same amendment of 1991 which is in place, which very categorically says that, you know, the and they themselves, till 2018 NSIT Act, they are themselves, the government, Delhi government is writing that it is the government needs Lieutenant Governor of the NCT.
Well, Geeta, like I said in my opening comment also to you, all of that is not true. You know that. All of that does not stand. This bill is not what you are saying
about. There. You can check
all
it.
Of that is not true. But anyways, be that as it may, I think we got to wrap up our discussion now. Thank you all for joining us. As I see it, let me say this, as how I as a Delhi wala sees this is, I'm not worried about political ambitions of this party or the other. What I really care about is who's going to be accountable for my work. And if the LG can do it better, is there a mechanism for it? We don't know. Certainly so far, were the MLAs doing a better job? Well, you got to decide that and take the final words. That's it. We'll take a quick break.